Good morning and welcome to this service of worship of the First Presbyterian Church of Tuscaloosa. So glad that you have chosen to join us this morning by television or by live stream. The worship service you are now watching was recorded a few days ago, so to keep up with the very latest news about the church, consult the church email, website, or social media. This broadcast service, however, is not the only way that you can be worshiping with us. Today at 9 a.m., we will be worshiping in person in the Rose Garden outdoors, and then at 11 a.m., we will worship here in the sanctuary. We will keep this schedule going as long as it is safe and the weather cooperates. Please consult the church email for all the details about the health safety expectations if you are planning to come for in-person worship. But also know that we are going to continue to do these pre-recorded services so that you may worship with us at home. We have logos today for our children at 2 p.m. Youth group, check social media for details about your activities today. Middle school parents, there will be an informational meeting about the Montreat Middle School Conference, which will be coming up this summer. That informational meeting will be on Tuesday, November 17th at 6 p.m. by Zoom. This Sunday and next, we will be taking up a collection for the Presbyterian Women Thank Offering, which supports various ministries chosen by Presbyterian Women of the Presbyterian Church USA. You can give electronically by clicking on the blue Give Now button on our church website and click on the PW Thank Offering link. A reminder that Thanksgiving bags to support the community soup bowl as we seek to feed the hungry and food insecure this holiday season. Those bags are due back on November the 18th. You can also donate to cover the cost of one of those bags. Again, details are in the church email. Wanted to draw your attention to the work of the nominating committee. They are requesting suggestions from the congregation for the office of elder and deacon. Check the email and website so you can learn more and make your nominations. I also wanted to let you know that a video of the closing bicentennial celebration service we had just a couple of weeks ago was put together for those who could not join with us in person. A link to that video was included in the church email that was sent out this past Friday. Today is the last Sunday for Dong Q Lee, who has been an invaluable part of our choir and the music ministry here at First Pres these past couple of years while he has been in graduate school. He will soon be heading back to his native South Korea. We wanted to say thank you to him and all God's blessings in what is sure to be a bright future. Thanks again to all who have given to the church financially during this time of separation. Since we cannot pass an offering plate during this service, would you please consider going to the church website and clicking on the blue Give Now button so that you can make your offering electronically. You can also fill out an online pledge card online there on our website if you have not done so already. And a big thanks to all who have given, who have pledged, or will be doing so shortly. Well, even though we cannot be together today and cannot see each other, I would like to acknowledge and express the admiration and gratitude of our congregation to all of the veterans in our congregation and throughout our nation. Thank you and your families for your dedicated service. Let us worship God.
Friends, please rise as you are able in body or in spirit for the call to worship. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword?
As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered.
No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us.
For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Let us worship God.
Thank you.
Friends, let us pray. God of the seasons, even while we cry out, "How long, Lord, will you hide yourself from sight? Remember how fleeting is our life." You send Jesus Christ to be the light of the world. Free us from all that darkens and ensnares us, and let us be like a light for others. Through the power of Him who is alive and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Friends, the truth is, our sin is always before God. We can never hide anything from the Maker. But we do come before our Creator seeking forgiveness, grace, and wisdom in order to better reflect the love and the life of our Savior. Let us now confess our sins before God and one another as we pray.
Holy God, you see us as we are and know our inmost thoughts. You have called us to live as ones prepared to die, and yet also to live life to the fullest all our days. We confess that we have failed on both counts. We put off things that need doing and words that need to be spoken. We live in the prisons of fear, forgetting your power, which has conquered all things, even death itself. Forgive our weak faith. Pardon our poor vision. Cleanse us of our sin. Restore to us the joy of our salvation, that we may faithfully and confidently live as your children.
Amen. Our God is merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Friends, hear the good news and be at peace. Through Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen. As God has given us signs of grace and love, it is only fitting that we share these signs with one another. May the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Peace, Michael. Peace, Luann. Peace, friends.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Well, good morning, girls and boys. Once again, I am so happy and excited to spend time with you this Sunday morning. And I know it might be hard, but I want y'all to imagine what life was like before smartphones and tablets and computers and laptops and email and the internet. Now, this might be hard to believe, but for the longest time, when someone wanted to talk with someone else who lived far, far away, they would write a letter. Our Bible story from this morning is actually a letter written to a man named Timothy. I'm not going to lie, it's a really long letter. So I thought I would write a letter to Pastor Michael to help us understand what is going on, but please, 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 don't tell him what I'm writing. I want it to be a secret and a surprise. Dear Pastor Michael, I have a lot of complaints. My biggest complaint is that I need more time. It would be great if you could add more time into the day, period. That way, all of the staff could finish what we need to finish. There are a lot of other complaints I have, but I don't have enough time to list them. Just to remind you, comma, please give us more time, exclamation point, sincerely, Pastor Andy. Nice. Now, I really do wish that it was that easy, that we could have more time to do things by just asking to have more time. But God only gives us so much time in a day. We don't have to be busy all the time. I want us to remember that God took a break and God rested. God might have even taken a nap. But God still wants us to use the time that God gives us wisely. If we lay around all day, we won't have enough time to do the things we actually need to do. It's better if we get all of our chores or tasks or homework out of the way so we can take a break and rest just like God did. Will y'all pray with me, please? Dear God,
dear God,
thank you for loving us.
Thank you for loving us.
Thank you for giving us.
Thank you for giving us
time each day.
Time each day
to do the things.
To do the things
you want us to do.
You want us to do.
Help us to work.
Help us to work
when we need to.
When we need to.
And rest.
And rest
when you want us to.
When you want us to.
We love you, God.
We love you, God.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, boys and girls, I will see you next week.
Let us turn to God's word in prayer. Spirit of life, we do not know how to pray as we ought. Meet us in words written, in words spoken. Intercede for us with sighs too deep for words until we shine with the hope that is hidden in our hearts. For we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Our scripture lesson is from the book of 2 Timothy, chapter 4, beginning with verse 6 through 22. Hear the word of the Lord. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. do your best to come to me soon. For Demas, in love with this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica. Crescens has Luke is with me. Get Mark and bring him with you, for he is useful in my ministry. I have sent Tychicus to Ephesus. When you come, bring the cloak that I left with Carpus at Troas, also the books, and above all the parchments. Alexander the coppersmith did me great harm. The Lord will pay him back for his deeds. You also must beware of him, for he strongly opposed our message. At my first defense, no one came to my support, but all deserted me. May it not be counted against them. But the Lord stood by me and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed, and all the Gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack and save me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Greet Prisca and Aquila and the household of Onesiphorus. Erastus remained in Corinth. Trophimus I left ill in Miletus. Do your best to come before winter. Eubulus sends greetings to you, as do Pudens and Linus and Claudia and all the brothers and sisters. The Lord be with your spirit. Grace be with you. This is the word of the Lord.
As most of you know, my family and I moved here from Western North Carolina 4 years ago, and I must tell you, the foothills of Western North Carolina are gorgeous this time of year, as the leaves change from a verdant green to a brilliant gold, orange, or red. It's truly breathtaking. But as autumn progresses, however, each of those leaves dry up, fall to the ground, crunch underfoot, and eventually become soil, which nurtures the dazzling display that next year will bring forth. People come from all over the country to witness the colors of fall as so vividly displayed in the Carolina mountains. People come from all over to make a similar pilgrimage to Tuscaloosa to witness certain colors, mainly crimson and white. But there are also beautiful colors that reveal themselves within God's created order in the fall in western Alabama. They all signal the progression of the natural and inevitable change of seasons. These colors are accompanied by front porches decked with pumpkins, mums, and sometimes mummies. Cool snaps begin to materialize, each one lasting a bit longer than the last. The thick, lush green of hot weather grass lawns is overtaken by golden, brittle strands. The smells of first fires in the hearth sweeten late afternoon walks. Then the time changes and suddenly dusk arrives at 4:30 each day. Yes, no matter where you call home, there are signs all around that the observant ones know, signal the progression of autumn, which means undoubtedly that winter is just around the corner. The Reverend Dr. Clarence McCartney, when he was a young man, was called to be the pastor of the First Presbyterian Church of Pittsburgh. In 1915, he preached a sermon entitled, Come Before Winter, based on our scripture lesson today. It so moved and inspired the congregation that the session invited him to preach the same sermon again the very next year. He did so, and then proceeded to preach it again every year for the next 37 years. It became one of the most influential sermons of the 20th century. K. Countless pastors have carried on this tradition with sermons of their own based on the same scripture lesson. Influential pastors in my life have done it, and it is a tradition that I have practiced in my own ministry. And so I now stand in a Presbyterian pulpit to preach this sermon for the 15th November in a row. The second letter of Paul to his young protege and beloved companion in ministry, Timothy, was written in the winter of the great apostle's life. 2 Timothy is the last writing we have from the Apostle Paul. It was written during his final imprisonment in Rome. He was old and sick. Death was near, and he knew it. Tradition has it that shortly after the writing of this letter, Paul stood trial for the second time, was sentenced to be executed, and was taken outside the city gates where he was beheaded. These words at the end of 2 Timothy are therefore Paul's departing words, the significant last words of a significant man indeed. The finality of Paul's tone is quite apparent. For I am already on the point of being sacrificed. The time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day, and not only to me, but to all who have longed for his appearing. These are Paul's final words. The end is near, and he knows it. He doesn't shy away from the fact that he will soon be dying. Paul faces death head on. He is not scared. He is at peace. He's done all he can do. He's fought the good fight. He's run his race, and now he knows that a finish line is almost in sight, and on the other side of that line, there is a crown waiting for him. Paul knows that death is near, and he knows it is a part, a necessary part of the completion of God's plan. So he faces it head on without fear. I will never forget the first time I set foot on this church property. The pastor nominating committee smuggled Laura and me in here at night so that we wouldn't run into any church members or staff. We came in through the rose garden, and it was all lit up, as beautiful and peaceful as ever. When they pointed out to me that it was also a columbarium where rest the ashes of the dearly departed of this church, I got chills, but not because I thought it was morbid, because I thought it was beautiful. I absolutely love the fact that the main entranceway to our church, the place where we greet each other, laugh, tell stories, have lemonade and egg hunts, and as of this year now have worship committee meetings and programming for people of all ages, that space is essentially a graveyard. I love the symbolism of that. We are a people of faith, faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, who died, who rose again, who conquered death for us all. I love the fact that as we come and go and greet and laugh and gather in that place, we are facing death head on. And because of the promises of God, we can do so without fear. And we can do so with a deep-seated joy and confidence. Paul's letter also has a very personal and specific nature to it, which we see in the next few verses. Do your best to come to me soon, writes Paul in verse 9. He wants his companion Timothy by his side. When time is precious and fading, we want more than anything to be surrounded by those that mean the most to us. But Paul knows it needs to happen quickly if it would happen at all. Travel at that time was slow. It would take 3 to 4 months for Timothy to receive this letter and then return and travel to Paul. And travel by boat ceased in the winter months. It was a now or never situation for Timothy. Sometimes we are faced with now or never situations. How do we respond to them? Sometimes our faith calls us in challenging ways, calls us to sacrifice, to endure, to act when we don't want to act, when acting or speaking is the last thing on earth we want to do. How do we respond when our faith calls us to now or never kinds of challenges? Our scripture lesson illustrates several types of responses to this call. For Demas, in love with this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica. Crescens has gone to Galatia, Titus to Dalmatia. Luke alone is with me. All but one of Paul's companions left him in his hour of need. Is that how we respond to the call of faith? By vanishing right when we're needed most? How do we respond to the call of faith, to the challenging, sacrificial, taxing, demanding, do or die, now or never, even sometimes seemingly monotonous call of faith? Paul continues this personal letter. Bring Mark, he's a good friend. He'll be useful to me. Oh, and bring my cloak. I left it with Carpus at Troas. I'll need that. And especially my books and my parchments. Please bring those to me. Here is Paul at the end of his life, the end of his days. He is in prison. He can't do anything else to benefit anyone, can he? He can't be useful. He can't contribute, right? Wrong. He wants his books and his parchments. Even in his isolation, Paul wants to continue to study, to learn, to grow, to pray, to write letters of encouragement, to serve God as long as he is able. Every day that we are given is a day to grow deeper in faith, to grow closer to God through study, prayer, and meditation. Every day we're given is an opportunity to be an encouragement to another human being, whether in person or from a distance. No one is ever too old for that. After warning Timothy of an individual who greatly opposed the gospel ministry, Paul continues to greet specific people that both he and Timothy knew. And then he says these words, which have been interpreted with such great significance over the years. Do your best to come before winter. Friends, we all have need to do our best to come before winter. To do something or say something today before it's too late. We all face now or never situations. And in fact, on this very day, we face a now or never situation here in this church, in this community, in our lives. As a people of faith, we face death head on because we know that for us, it leads to eternal life. I'm not trying to be grim here, but the reality is that there are people sitting here today who will not be here next year to hear this sermon again. For those people, though we do not know who they are, there might be words to say or things to do while there is still the opportunity. And to everyone else who will, by the grace of God, be sitting here next year, you might be sitting then next to an empty seat, the seat of someone you needed to say something to or do something for. For 15 years, I have been saying those exact same words in this sermon. But never has there been such a palpable poignancy to them as today, preaching these words into this empty sanctuary. Never have we been given a more direct reminder that we just never know what tomorrow will bring, who will be given another day, and who won't. What is it that you need to say or do today before the chance has escaped you. Over the years I have been preaching it, this annual sermon has taken on a life of its own. For you here in Alabama, this is but the fourth time you could have heard this sermon. Friends in North Carolina heard me preach it 11 times. And some have told me that they still tune in on Come Before Winter Sunday. Each year I have preached basically the same sermon, but changed the concluding illustration. I tell the story of someone's life, and usually their death, and how their story gives witness to the message of Come Before Winter. I have chosen over the years church members, friends, family, people I knew and loved deeply, people I did not know personally, the old, the young. One year I even preached about a dog. Each year, though, a different individual or family whose life and death is a clarion call to get our house in order. And because of the annual nature of this sermon, I am always on the lookout for my next Come Before Winter story, my next Come Before Winter candidate. I had an older gentleman in North Carolina once say, "Preacher, I love that sermon. I just don't ever want to be in it." So I am always on the lookout for my next Come Before Winter candidate all throughout the year. For 2020, however, it is the year that is the illustration of this message. Every one of us knows someone who's died from coronavirus. Everyone knows a family who will have an empty chair at the Thanksgiving table, if they get to the Thanksgiving table at all. Every one of us has been cut to the heart hearing somebody's story that reminds us how precious and precarious life truly is. So I'm not going to tell one person's story today. Instead, I'm going to invite you to reflect and even act today. As I have said, I have spent the last 15 years of my life on the lookout for my next Come Before Winter candidate. But today I'm asking you, who would be yours? Whose life and witness call you to action this day, be it by their faithful example of making the most of the days that God gave them, or perhaps someone comes to mind who may not have many days left. Who is your Come Before Winter candidate, and what will you do about it today? I am asking and even challenging everyone who hears this sermon to respond to it somehow today. Pick up the phone. Send a letter. Send an email, a text. Thank you for the blessing you have been in my life. It might be that simple. But what if we all did that? What a collective injection of love, grace, hope and goodness that would be to this little corner of God's world. And what a perfect time for such an injection. But will we actually do it? Or will we put it off until a tomorrow that somehow never materializes? It's cool outside. It's getting dark earlier and earlier each night, and the progression of autumn colors marches on. It's showing all the signs that winter is just around the corner. But the plain truth is, we just never know precisely when winter arrives for any of us. So let this word and this sermon be a call to us all to get our house in order, to get right with God, with others, with ourselves, to prepare ourselves to live without regrets and to die with peace. Let it call us to reflect, to speak, to act, to open our eyes, to change as led by God. Let it be a call and a reminder that life is fragile and precious and filled with so many divinely given opportunities, but not as many as there were yesterday. Let it be a call to each and every soul who hears these words to do your best to come before winter. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
You see that we have a rose here. We, with joy, announce the birth of Philip Glenn Weaver III, who will be called Tripp, son of Philip and Brittany Weaver. Tripp was born on Wednesday, November 4th at DCH. Proud grandparents are Philip and Mojo Weaver and Aunt Jenny. For other concerns, please refer to the email that went out on this day. Let us pray. Holy God, you send your Son to be with us, and your Son invites us into the life he shares with you. And so we keep coming because we want to live. Receive us in our frailty, our complacency, and in our desires. We pray for your church all over the world, that we would be seed and yeast where life has grown barren and heavy. May the life we discover in you bind us to each other and to the world you love, For no need is beyond the strength of your call, and no child of yours is expendable. Merciful God, give us wisdom and courage beyond our imagining. We pray for friends and strangers bearing the brunt of this pandemic, for those impacted by the virus, striving to recover, for those grieving the loss of a loved one, for those on the front lines of health care and child care and community care, from sanitation and safety to food growth and preparation. We pray for those struggling, whether to purchase enough food or to find work and affordable housing in the midst of layoffs and downsizes. We pray for our nation. In the wake of a divisive election, we recognize the tears in the fabric of our communal life. We do not always have the power to overcome animosity on our own. We need your intervention and transformation. Grant those in positions of earthly power, humility and wisdom, spiritual maturity and a willingness to listen. May each of us be catalysts for good wherever we have influence. We pray for those who protect our nation, for the women and men in uniform who give of themselves for our freedoms and life. To them we say thank you. There is power in unity. There is power in courage to defend what is right. There is power in knowing that you, God, fight on our behalf. There is power in the one who sets us free. This service of love and sacrifice on behalf of others points us to the greatest love of all, the very gift and sacrifice of Christ, our Savior, who was willing to pay the ultimate price so that we might live free. It is in his words that we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. In giving to God, we grow closer to God. Let us offer our life and labor to the one who draws near and freely gives the treasure of eternal life in Christ Jesus. Thank you. Let us pray. Holy One, receive these offerings as you receive our lives. Gather our false starts and uncertain efforts, our generosity and our reluctance. Enliven us with your breath and make your purposes known, that our lives might show forth your glory. For we pray in the name of Jesus and by the power of your Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
come before winter. To be honest, there are many people predicting a very harsh one up ahead. So perhaps we might amend that to say, come before tomorrow. Friends, make today count. And as you continue your journey of faith, remember that you go not alone. By the power of the Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ walks with you every day. He goes above to protect. He goes below to support. He goes in front to guide. He goes behind to encourage. And remember that he walks beside you, because above all, he loves you. Knowing this great love, let us therefore go in his name, spreading the good news until we meet again. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest upon and remain with you and those you love, both this day and forevermore. Amen.
Light comes for the righteous and joy.